Yeah, you guys are going to join the rest of the band in a short while. The way you record an album, as I understand it, is that you record a lot of songs. And yeah. Then you have something called the campfire test.
Yeah, well, we write a lot of songs. So between tours and gigs, we try and get together in a studio. It's usually in London or in New York. It seems to be where we end up writing together. We convene and we share our ideas. And we came to a point in preparation for Delta where we had probably 40-ish songs.
Yeah.
And they were all in different stages of being worked up and different stages of existence. And we were a bit lost in it, so we decided we'd do something that we now call the campfire test, which is basically you record everything, just Marcus and the guitar singing.
So take a song, the song that you're going to do here later.
Mm-hmm. Well, the thing about songs is sometimes bad songs can hide behind good production. Oh. So you can get all the smoke and mirrors and all the kind of fancy-sounding stuff, and then when you strip it back, the song's actually not that good. So that's why we sort of strip them back. But Guiding Light started... literally like this. All day permanent bread, the glaze on my eyes. When I heard your voice, the distance caught me by surprise again. And I know you claim that you're all right. That was all fine. And then the chorus goes, and I know it all. Don't just sit with folded hands and become blind. Ben added this chord. But even when there is no star inside, you'll always be my guiding light.
So Marky does that, and then we all sort of jump on it and start messing around, and it sort of grows and grows into this thing that exists on the record.
But it could stand the campfire test.
That's well, it survived, yeah.
So what would you say?
I won't play the ones that didn't.
Before you put that away, tell me, what is the best campfire song of all songs?
Oh, wow. That's a really hard question to answer. Do you know what's not a good one? The Final Countdown.
What? That's a Swedish one.
I know, it's a great song. It's not a great campfire song. So I don't know what the best I don't know. Probably like one of the old gospel ones, you know, like the ones that don't require that much instrumentation. Like Lean On Me or Lean On Me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend, and I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need. Yeah, basically ones that you don't have to look up the chords.
Exactly. Mine would be Tom Dooley, and then it's over, you know? It's
like, oh, wow. Oh, yeah.
Short night at campfire.
Not even finishing roasting your marshmallow.
And now you're in this business, and you obviously going to stay in this business. And you're touring a lot, right?
Mm-hmm.
How is that? I mean, getting grown up, growing up, like, now you're grown-ups. You are, I have to say. Do you have kids?
No.
You have kids, right?
I have two, yeah.
How is this business?
How many do you have? Like 12?
Well, you've got loads of kids, haven't you?
Well, I got loads.
They're everywhere.
Yeah. I have six. Yeah.
Six? That's a lot of kids.
But anyway, I would say that my business is not an easy combination to combine this line of work with being ever-present father.
Mm-hmm.
How is that for you touring?
Well, we're about to find out. I've had two kids since we put out the last album, so we toured a bit with my first. We haven't toured with both of them yet. I think it's hard for anyone who works, mothers and fathers. Trying to be a working parent is something you just got to figure out. I think in general, it's probably much more difficult for women than it is for men. Yeah, it's like anything. I mean, I think we want to work as hard. We feel privileged. We feel like we're in a position to be able to be a band for a long time if we can keep our shit together. And I think we want to pursue that with working as hard as possible. And at times, that obviously means the kind of sacrifices like being away from your kids. But then at times, the way our sort of touring schedule works, we'll be home for a little bit. And, you know, I think we are, we have no complaints, you know.
But you tour for such a long time. I mean, you have to find something.
We've made the sort of touring environment quite hospitable. We've had Marky's kids out on the road, mm-hmm. which is awesome. It's really great. It's like, we've always laid down kind of a family vibe yeah. of our crew, and we roll with quite a big number of people now. So to have a few kids involved in that mix, it feels
It's not
natural.
Like Dad will be home in 3 months.
No.
It's like 2 hours after the gig, he'll be.
Yeah, my family, we have a 2-week rule. So whatever happens, we try and make sure we see each other every 2 weeks, which helps.
Which is a very good rule, I think.
Yeah, it's important.
Anyway, you are about to take the stage, and we're all a bit starstruck that you're here tonight, and with a lot of, a big production, and we really love that. But are you ever starstruck yourself?
All the time.
When is that?
And I never want to stop being starstruck as well. I think when you stop being... When you meet your heroes, I mean, I'm pretty sure you're just being flattering because I'm not sure we're your heroes, but when you meet your heroes, you know, I never want to stop being kind of awestruck that we're able to shake hands and talk with these people. And most of the time we find that they're, you know, pretty down-to-earth regular people who can look you in the eye and have a good conversation. And
You shared a stage with Bruce Springsteen?
We did share a stage with Bruce Springsteen.
Are you a fan?
I know what's coming here. It was somewhat embarrassing. Yes, I mean, he's probably the most important songwriter in my life. I grew up listening to his songs in the car with my parents a lot. I've always loved his music. You haven't got a clip, have
How
you?
Did it go?
Well, we were quite overexcited. We finished our set. And we looked to our right and we saw Springsteen standing side of stage watching our show and seemingly enjoying it. And he said afterwards that he had enjoyed it. And then when he was on stage, he beckoned over to us. And we, at this point, were pretty overexcited. We'd overindulged in various ways. And we look, and he beckons like this in our direction. We look over our shoulder, thinking there's someone much cooler standing behind us, like Arcade Fire, Radiohead or something. And no, he's like beckoning at us to come on stage for a song.
One of his songs.
One of his songs.
His songs.
Which one?
It's called Hungry Heart. And Hungry Heart is a very easy song to sing. The lyrics just go round and round and round.
And if you're a fan, you.
And if you're a fan, you know it.
And the clue is in the title as well.
The clue is also in the title. And I forgot the lyrics.
You did?
Which is very hard to do. But I forgot the lyrics.
So what did you do then?
Grabbed a pair of maracas. Just started shaking.
Always the best solution.
Maracas.
If you have maracas, everything will go well anyway. Thank you so much. Stage is yours, guys. Thank you so much.
Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.